So as you guys may have noticed, we didn't really get the windshield out like I had hoped to. I started cutting into it with a wire. It started dragging really, really bad than I'm used to. I tried oil on the wire, using dish soap on the wire, any method I could to try to lubricate the wire better than what I could. And it wasn't having it. I got to a point where I got hung up and it actually started cracking the glass. I just started, for some reason, cutting into the glass. I don't know if I hit like a chip on the underside or whatnot, but I couldn't go any farther from there. So I ended up just smashing it out. Once I started cutting into it more with the putty knives, I think I figured out what the problem was. It looks like the windshield that was in this car was not the stock windshield. The amount of polyurethane that they used to seal this new windshield in was probably about two, if not almost three times thicker and harder than what stock OEM polyurethane is for the windshield. Because I've removed a couple of windshields using my wire method from stock cars and never, specifically 3000 GTs and Stealths, and never had an issue like I did here. I've got safe lights already scheduled. They'll be out here in the next couple days to install the new windshield. In the meantime, mail came today, so that means I had parts come in the mail, so I'm going to work on that stuff. Mainly the power steering pump, which is one of the main things that's holding me up on the motor. I need to get the power steering pump rebuilt because the main front seal on it was leaking behind the bearing. So I'm just going to do an entire rebuild job on that, which I will show you here shortly. So as I said earlier, one of the things I've been waiting on for the engine is my power steering rebuild kit here. So my power steering, I've always had a small leak coming out the front assembly. I've already swapped one pump out with another spare I have, and it fixed the leak a little bit, but it basically just comes down to the point I just need to get it rebuilt, because I don't intend to drop $300 some odd on a new power steering pump. So, especially when the rebuild kits are only about $20. So I just went online and just looked up power steering rebuild kit and got this premium seal kit. It does have all the seals I need in it. Mainly the seal that was leaking was this axle looking seal here. This is basically the seal that goes here. It seals the fluid out from the bearing area. Basically it'd be like your front main seal on the power steering pump. And that taps in. So here's the front of the pump here. The outer ring is where the bearing goes, and the inner ring is where this seal will go. So it will just sit in there just like that. I'm gonna oil it up so when I press pop it in there, it doesn't get all messed up. So as for the rebuild instructions, I've never rebuilt one of these before, but I will give a shout out to Tony on 3SI, because on the 3SI wiki, he left a really good write-up on doing these power steering pumps. I just basically just use a socket that's big enough to cover the entire outside of the seal. You don't want it to cover on the inside of the seal here, because if you go to pop it in, it'll press and deform that. You want to get it on the outer ring here, which is metal. And there we go. Seal's all in. Go ahead and finish up here. So I'm going to get these parts here laid out so I know what goes where. Where is that? Okay. The one thing to be careful out, and what I've got wrapped up here, is basically, I guess this is like the pump vanes. Basically, it's a disc with all these real small metal squares in it. And what it does is, as it's spinning, those squares will come out, be forced out centrifugally. And that's what actually rotates or pumps the fluid out. But they're not attached to the center vein. So when you pull it out, they'll all fall out. So I just went and wrapped it up as nice as I could, try to keep them all in there so I don't lose any of them. Granted, I do have a spare pump sitting outside, but I hate to have to tear open a spare pump, that I could technically could rebuild if I wanted to and keep it as a fully functioning spare just because I lost a couple of these little vanes. But yeah, you can see them here. So they're just a bunch of vanes all the way around it. I'll set that off to the side there, and I've got all the vanes. This is a sending unit assembly here. And I'm just getting all the parts together here to reassemble it. Okay. But I gotta swap that seal out first. There's an O-ring right here. Get that swapped out. Let me find the right size one in here. I think it's that one. Nope, that's the wrong one. That thing's got a lot of seals in it. Or a lot of O-rings, should I say. There we go. And of course it didn't come with directions. So I basically just size up the O-rings. So, okay, so basically this, what this does here, this is the switch that tells the ECU to idle up. So when you're power steering, when you're basically turning your steering wheel, it will put load on the engine and the engine will want to compensate with that. So what it does is this, once this switch basically connects, the ECU sees it as the power steering pump is applying load to the engine, and it will bump the idle up more so that the engine doesn't die. So, and this basically just goes on top here. We've got a little pin that goes in first. There's a needle nose for this. Goes in first, and then this is basically the contact point. So what we got here is you put this in, and when it enough pressure hits, it basically makes contact and grounds the pin out. So on top, spring assembly. And then we screw it in. This is the, believe the high pressure in, yeah, this is high pressure into the pump, or high pressure out of the pump, I'm sorry. High pressure out of the pump. This is the weird fitting that sticks off the front out here that uses the banjo type hose end. It bolts on there. So this here goes out, high pressure out to the steering rack. So yeah, so just this assembly here had four O-rings on it. Okay, so all four O-rings on this here replaced. So let's take the four bad ones we took off here. And let's set them out of the way so we don't get them confused with new ones and end up putting garbage back on. Looking at this, the reassembly is a spring, and then this, I actually don't know what this is. I do know it's a one-way type of valve though, because when I was cleaning it out, I could only get, I got a screened area here on the bottom. I can only get fluid to flow out one direction. So, and of course I'll tighten all this stuff up later. Like wipe a little oil on these O-rings since I am putting together everything dry here. It'll help them seat in there like they should without actually binding and tearing the O-ring. So, and this here is the nut that goes on the end of it here. That goes right there. That is the this is the low pressure line in. There's an O-ring on it. Another trick I like to use too, especially when doing reassembly stuff, a lot of you engine builders should probably take note of this also. When you're dealing with tons of hardware and tons of bolts and stuff like that, it's really hard to keep track of things that you've tightened and things you haven't tightened. Because there's instances where you'll put something together just to hold something in place so you can work on something else for a time being. So the easiest way to go ahead and tell if something's been tightened down a lot, get a paint pen. Once you've tightened something down, just mark it. And that way I know right there that those two bolts have been tightened down. So, and this is just a Milwaukee Ingsoll pen. It's a real good pen because it's xylene and basically all the type of paint thinner type of materials, it's free of that. So if you're actually marking on something that's painted, it will dissolve the paint that you're marking it with. So I believe I'm to the point now where I can get this shaft put back in. Let me just oil this up real fast, oil this seal up, and we'll drop this shaft into place. And the fun part about this also is that the bearing here is press fit in. It's not extremely tight, but it's tight enough to be a pain in the butt. And to top it all off, whoever made these power steering pumps also decided to put a C-clip on the back side of it to hold it into the housing with a dust shield, which I don't have a bearing pull to get either one of them out, so I didn't mess with it. So let's see here how hard we can get this. See if we can actually get this in place. Oh, I feel it. There we go. So I think with just a few apps of the hammer here, we'll get this thing to seat in. There we go. Yep. Yeah, I thought so. The cut marks on the inside of the shaft here, they end pretty much right where the top portion is for this inside assembly. So when you're tapping this in, make sure to tap it all the way up and through. Other thing to note also is that there are two versions of the power steering pump. And the only differences I've noted is how the seals and shaft are put into place. The instructions that Tony has online goes into better detail about that. So you'd probably just go ahead and take a look at that if you had any questions on it. The big outer ring, O-ring here. And of course it's a little deformed. So that may get a little interesting to get that on there. Let's see. I have something. Let's try to flatten that out. Just a little bit before I put it in there. I think that'll work. So I've got one big O-ring left. This little one, I know where it goes. I don't need it because I've actually already replaced it on mine. It's a little O-ring for the pressure switch right here. If you take the clip out, pop that out, there's a little O-ring in there. I've already replaced it on mine because I have those size O-rings here, so I'm not worried about that one. So O-ring down. Okay, so see the assembly here. Now I'm believing I've got two assemblies, two portions here, a lower plate and then this outer way here, which line up with these guide pins. I believe I have it in place. Let me check if I got the lining up, if they're lined up right or not. I can't really tell. They look lined up to me, so I'm just going to assume that that it just needs to seat into that lower O-ring I put in. So let's put this upper one in.
that should be it. And you know you did it right when you go back and look and you don't have your leftover parts. Except for this was just the wire holder, which will go onto the top one there, so. Of course, the true test will be when I get it all assembled and it's leaking out of every orifice. But fingers crossed that that doesn't happen. So. But I'm going to go ahead and finish putting this thing together here. After I clean those bolts up, because they're a little greasy there. And then that'll be it for the power steering pump. One thing I did fail to mention that we weren't complete, even though I got the back plate on there, is that inside here is that clip, that C clip I need to get in place. The problem is there's a dust shield in here or something for the bearing that also needs to fall into place. And they made this thing so tight, it is so hard to get in here. Good thing is, at least I got these cutouts in the pulley itself. So I may be here a little bit trying to get this here to lock in. So it's all locked in now, all together. I'm gonna finish up buttoning up some things on the engine here. And I'm hoping this coming weekend, I'll be able to get the engine dropped in. Hey everyone, so SafeLight is finished up and we now have a brand new windshield in the car. It is going to be so nice to actually drive and be able to see out my glass. The last windshield was just so scratched up. In the daytime it was bearable, it just looked like it was really foggy, but at nighttime it was a nightmare to drive. The windshield wipers had scratched the glass up so bad that you couldn't see out of it at night. You get glares from the headlights and everything on it. So I really try to avoid driving at nighttime because of how bad the windshield was. So it'll be nice actually be able to drive this car and seeing out it. So they did an awesome job on here. Didn't have any issues at all. I'm sure they really appreciated showing up here and me already having the glass out and everything pretty much already prepped to begin with. So, but overall, yeah, it's great. And we'll continue on with things now.
So now that the windshield's out of the way, the one thing we're going to prep for is getting the engine ready to go back into the engine bay. So there's a few little things I need to take care of in the engine bay. All the parts have come in for the engine itself, the major parts, the ones I wanted to get installed before trying to put the engine back in. They're all done and out of the way. Last of them came in today. So I did want to go over the engine and just point out some things that I've been working on with it here.
New valve covers, the old carbon fiber dipped ones, I got rid of those. I actually put some Dodge valve covers back on, and I've powder coated both of them. It's a new color I found. It's called black oxide or black carbon. It's a light, real light texture, not like the stock Mitsubishi texture that it came with. It's a lot lighter than that, but it's a really nice, good, clean looking color that I went with. So yeah, both front and rear valve covers have been done. Most of the accessory brackets throughout the car have been taken off, blasted, powder coated gloss black, alternator bracket, engine mounts, stuff like that. I did get new wastegate actuators put on. They're Kingwana, I think. I cannot pronounce the name, but these are all aluminum built wastegates. I ended up getting a really good deal on these. Found them, one of the guys in the forum selling it. My old ones, they were still functional, but they were just really bad looking. I don't know if they were holding boost completely or not, but I shouldn't have any issues with these. These ones automatically come with a, I think, 12 PSI spring in them, so I'll be good there. And as for the turbos themselves, the turbos I have been using here are a 13G turbo. I got these turbos used off a guy online for $200. They needed to be rebuilt, so I went ahead and rebuilt them. Then I sent them down to a guy I know down in Florida who runs a shop called Turbo Bay Performance, and he handled the balancing on them. He also polished out the bearing journals and stuff like that, blasted all the wheels. I don't know if you can see it on the camera or not, but the whole char assembly, the inducer and exducer came back absolutely spotless and brand new. I've been running these turbos here for about a year now and have not had a single issue with them at all. They're running great, so I'm really looking forward to how they're going to run when they're back in the car and everything's all buttoned up. Turbo coolant lines both took off. Front and rears, powder coated them, a gloss black, with all new braided lines and fittings on there. On the other side here, so yeah, alternator brackets, engine mount brackets all taken off, powder coated. AC is back on with the new pulley system in place. Power steering pump has been installed. So this is all the drive belting on the front here. I won't have to deal with any belt or anything once the engine's in. One of the fun things I did was this sort of protective bracket here in between the heads. I had an extra one of those, and my old one was kind of rusted out, so I swapped that one in and powder coated my spare and swapped that one in. And that's a fun one because the timing belt and both intake cam gears had to come off in order to get that bracket in there. So that was an unexpected journey I wasn't really looking forward to. When I started on it, let's take this around. So both rear upper plenum stays, powder coated gloss black, new rear turbo feed. I've been using the braided line for quite some time now. The old one I had was a 36 inch, and yeah, it was a little too long. It would come in this big loop. So I got a 24 inch with a 9 degree on it. I got that all installed there. New stainless steel pre-cat, whatever you want to call it. Both the front and rear drain lines for the turbos removed and resealed. They did have some small or slow leaking on it, which is pretty much a common problem. I seem to never be able to get them to stop leaking, but hopefully this time with the engine out,
I was able to clean everything really well, apply a little light silicone, black silicone to the gaskets and get them installed. So hopefully I won't have any more issues with that. New rear sensor wire. This is one of the things I was waiting on here. Shout out to Ninja Performance for hooking me up with this and a few other parts. So this feeds, this is the sensor for the power steering and for the low oil pressure light. The low oil pressure sending unit, or the oil pressure sending unit for the gauge, is located over here. This is an aftermarket one. This uses a three-wire sensor, so power, signal, ground, which I usually will just tap in with a single line, but since I need three feeds into here, I've got a separate line coming from the firewall for this one here. So this one won't run into the main stock harness here. So about the only thing I have left are a few odd items on the top. I've got to try to figure out what I want to do with the fuel rails. I don't know if I want to polish them or if I want to powder coat them yet. I've got another set here I'm going to play with, and I'll figure it out from there whether or not I'll go with powder coated chrome or something like that. I don't know. Maybe an anodized blue. I've got a few other parts that I've done the blue anodized on, like the brake calipers. So I may go that route. Not sure yet on it, but we'll figure it out. They're not too important right now because it's something I can easily access once the engine's in. So no worries on that. So I got to finish up a few little items here in the engine bay. And then probably we'll get all that done toward this weekend is when I'm planning on trying to do the engine drop. I'm going to try to get a friend out here to give me a hand just so I can get the engine in here without banging everything up. We're just going to go into the front, the front and rear mounts. The driver's side mounts won't get installed until the engine's in there because that one's kind of wonky and I don't want to scratch up all that paint over there. So I'll get the front and rears locked in and then we'll go ahead and slide the driver's side in there. Yeah, one thing to note too is that when we do go ahead and put the engine in the engine bay, it will just be the engine. The transmission won't be going in at this time. I'll be taking the transmissions out to get them rebuilt. I've got two transmissions here, two 5-speeds. I'm going to see if I can take two and make one good one. The transmission I have has a little bit of a grind in fifth gear and a really bad bearing rattle, which I don't know if it's an in-case bearing or the input shaft bearing or whatnot. I've already replaced the input shaft bearing once with an OEM one, and it didn't really help. So I don't know. We're gonna crack them both open and see what we can figure out with it. But that won't be coming until probably in December is when I'll start getting on the transmissions. But it's not a big thing. They're both bagged and underneath the stairs here in the garage. So they're not in the way. Getting the engine in and getting it out of the way so I can start working on the paint on the rest of the car is more of a priority. So. I'm not putting the engine in the car to make the car mobile by any means. It's just going in there so it's out of the way and all the parts I have for the engine bay and the drivetrain and all that can go into the car as much as possible to make room for all the other body panel parts that are becoming off so we can prep for paint. So I'm going to go ahead and touch up all the little things I need to do here in the engine bay and on the engine, and then we'll get prepped to get the engine back in.